Hello, everybody. It's great to be here. And I would like to start sharing with you a story. No? So I would like to know how many of you have seen The Power of Community? Okay. I won't try to repeat some of the data, but I think it's very important. Three things, you know, give some context about the history of the country, environmental and socially. Give some numbers that update what happens. But even when the film was done in 2006, it mostly talks about what happens started to happen in the early 90s, and some reflections. It's not in Spanish, okay? It's just that part, no? The program and the not-for-profit organization that I'm working with. Basically, this is a typical scene that you will see in Havana, even now. Now lots of cars, models, all before 1960, and they still work. They requires a lot of fuel. But all parts are handcrafted by hands in Cuba because of the American embargo. We cannot import the parts. I give you an idea of the use of like proper technology. But this is still common, it's shared with this. This is a very frequent image also in Havana City as well. Some context data, no? Cuba, which is not a single island. There are more than the southern islands around there. Even when most of them, like, nobody's living. But when you compare the size of some of these islands with the Lesser Antilles, they're equivalent, sometimes bigger. The surface of Cuba fits three times in Victoria. But we have half of the population of Australia living there. That's a density of population of 110 inhabitants per square kilometers. Havana is by far the biggest city in the Caribbean, and it occupies only 730 square kilometers. So 19% of the population of the country live in less than 1% of the surface. 75% of the population is considered by United Nations standards urban. And this humid tropical climate with this marine influence make the country scape to the fate that along that layer latitude, when you go into the continents, they're all deserts. We are not a desert, but we have been heavily affected historically by hurricanes, by climate like changes in climates and lately extreme events, you know. So there is no El Niño and La Niña anymore. The weather is totally crazy, not reliable. We can get force five hurricane in a season. Force five hurricane means sustained winds of 280 square kilometers per hour. The other day you get a storm of 135. That for us, that's a cyclone. And we can have probably 10 a year, something like that. Or storms and things like that. Just to give you an idea, like this Caribbean Sea is like a boiling pot of water. So all hurricanes, this is the perfect place for them to form. That wasn't me. For some people, this is the starting point of what is called the written history. Why? Because Columbus arrived, no? In October of 1492. But of course, there were history in the islands long before Columbus arrived. He didn't discover anything. The true discoverers of all of these islands that I don't share the denomination of American Mediterranean, because that has nothing to deal with our climate and things like that. It's a bunch of islands that they were created by totally different processes. Just to put you an example, Cuba geologically is placed on the North American plate. Just right the border between the Caribbean plate is right here. When we have our highest mountains, 2,000 meters, and the Oriente well, which is minus 5,000. And so right there, the Caribbean plate goes under the North American plate, and our mountains are growing. But naturally, all the nature that can be appreciated in all of the islands is totally related to South America. Not even with Central America, South America. And especially Amazonian type rainforests like this one. This is Salto Fino, 135 meters. The highest waterfall in the Caribbean. We're very proud of it. Even when I went to Katumba and the Blue Mountains, I saw bigger things there. But, you know, as we say in Cuba, lo mío primero, my things first. This route that you see here is like an expedition that was done by a group of nations, all of those nations, and a Cuban crew. In 5 canoes built by the Quechua India, Aborina people, indigenous people, they like to be called like that, in Ecuador. And it took 1.5 years to row from that part to Havana, just to prove the highway, that there was a perfect communication between the Amazonas watershed, the Orinoco Basin, and the Caribbean. And so the population, when Columbus arrived, especially the smaller group where that they were doing pottery and some agriculture, especially based in cassava. Exactly in 1505, Diego Velázquez arrived and started killing Aborina people. Okay? That was basically what they do. They divided the areas in circular huge spaces. And they called them atos. And they gave it to the most important people that came from Spain. Everything inside that area belongs to the landlord, including human beings. The smaller areas right here, circular areas, were for cattle use, corrales in Spanish. And the crown land is only the space between circles, here, there, there. So all the rest of the population that was arriving to the country, or slaves that became free, and the remnants of the Aborina population that it was almost gone by 1700s, have to crowd it in those little spaces. This is Havana Bay. And you can ask, why there are not circular spaces here? Because the king of Spain banned the agricultural use of the land around the bay just to keep the forest as spare parts for the fleet, masts and things like that. In fact, many of the so-called invincible armada that was destroyed in Trafalgar by Nelson, but he died there, were built in Cuban shipyards, right there.